Human shelter takes many forms. We gather from the environment around us, sand and gravel, timber and stones, and we shape them into the stuff of homes, schools, and factories. We owe our skill as builders to the lessons of generations and to the fabric of our cultures. But there are other architects. They also depend on the world around them for the bricks and mortar of their creations. They produce intricate sand sculptures to snare prey and knit sturdy basket nests to shelter their young. They fashion elaborate armor casing as protection from predators and create sophisticated underwater diving bells. They are carpenters, masons, engineers, and weavers too. They are the animal architects. Human beings are builders. We use the materials nature puts at our disposal, and we rework them into simple houses, elaborate office complexes, towering skyscrapers. And though there are many forms and functions to our structures, we build primarily, in the end, to put a roof over our heads. Animal architects must also depend on the world around them. The hallmark of their survival is the ability to use materials from their surroundings to fulfill their needs for protection and for shelter. There are many animals that find housing by taking residence in existing habitats. Like the owl, they are squatters. At the seashore, the activities of people make it easy for some squatters to find refuge. Usually, blennies live in the crevices of rock pools, but they can also make do with any other haven that's available. They are resourceful fish that can make use of objects another species leaves behind. The blenny chooses cover with its tactile senses, not sight. It seeks protection here, even though the glass is transparent. Litter provides accommodations for a great many animals. There was a time when tube worms were very rare on sandy shores, but around bottle-scarred beaches, they now have no difficulty finding a firm surface on which to build. The whelk, a carnivorous snail, grows its shelter, producing the material from a gland. The shell is an extension of the animal's own skin, which grows as the whelk grows, so it's always a perfect fit. But when the whelk dies, there's a squatter waiting for its cast-off shell. Most crustaceans have hard armor shells, but the hermit crab is soft, except for its claws. It is therefore vulnerable and must seek out quarters that will provide it with protection. A hermit crab won't evict the original owner. It simply waits for the whelk to die or to be eaten by a predator that leaves the shell intact. In studying the hermit crab, marine biologists crafted a glass shell finely measured and accurately made, which, in the absence of other options, the crab will inhabit. It holds itself in by gripping the interior with its back walking legs and a patch of wart-covered skin. But crabs grow, and shells can't once their owner has died. So each time the crab molts, it has to find a new shell a size larger. This hermit is not alone inside the shell. A little bristle worm joins it to feed off a share of the crab's food. Requirements for a new shell are not only that it should be larger, it must also be empty. That's the first thing the crab will check. Notice how the crab flicks its antennae, sampling the water near the shell. It smells in this way and can determine whether the shell is vacant. Then the crab uses its sense of touch to figure out the size and shape of the shell. Measures the entrance with its larger claw. If the shell meets its requirements, the crab hops across. Sometimes a crab will investigate and move into a new shell even before it has outgrown its old one. The worm follows its landlord into their new shelter. There is often another member in this household. Some hermit crabs carry anemones on their backs. Scientists aren't sure what prompts this pairing, but this rare film sequence seems to indicate that the anemone is a willing partner in the association. A whelk shell, occupied by a hermit crab, seems irresistible to anemones. Suggest that the texture of the shell's outer layer adds to the attraction. But since anemones don't usually climb aboard if the whelk is still inside, the crab must make some contribution as well. Now the crab is armed with a plume of stinging tentacles, and the anemone no longer has to wait in one spot until food drifts into its mouth. The crab will carry it to parts of the rock pool which other more stationary anemones can't reach. And the crab's untidy eating habits means there are plenty of leftovers for the anemone. With the tube worm also on board, the whelk shell serves as a mobile home for a small, symbiotic community. Back on shore, there's an animal so common and small, it usually goes unnoticed. In fact, most people don't realize that it's an animal at all. To the bare feet of a swimmer or beachcomber, it feels like crunchy seaweed. It's called a sand mason worm. At low tide, its turrets stick up from the sand like bedraggled little tails. The tubes are hammered by the waves even on a calm day. In rough weather, they can be utterly destroyed. But the worm is very quick to replace them once it's completely submerged again. It has a crown of tentacles, which it extends from a short collar of sand. The worm creates this vertical burrow, but that's not the extent of its skills. First, it has to spit out the sand which was washed in at low tide, and then it starts building. The worm picks up sand, a grain at a time, and adds it to its structure. Human masons also build, a brick or stone at a time, setting their work with cement mortar. It is from these masons that the worm gets its name. The tiny bricks of this mason's work are held together by a strong, waterproof mortar produced by a cement gland. The sand mason worm builds with slow precision. This time-lapse photography shows the intricacy of its efforts. The end result is a tough, branching tree of sand, which feeds the worm by trapping food particles drifting in the water. The cement this worm produces is so strong and flexible that each branch, though often only as wide as a single grain of sand, can withstand the swift currents created by the breakers above. The sand mason worm builds its superstructure on sandy ocean shores. On still freshwater ponds, another architect constructs a very different kind of underwater habitat. This dome of silk is filled up with air like a diving bell. It's held in place by attachments to the water weed. It is the lair of the water spider. The spider is a terrestrial air breather that has adapted to the foreign properties of water. In slow-moving streams and ponds, the female spider uses an amazing construction method to create an effective underwater shelter and nest. The openings to the spider's air tubes are on its abdomen. It breathes from a bubble trapped here by the furry, waterproof hairs of its body. It replenishes the supply by regular visits to the surface. When building a new diving bell, the spider starts by spinning a tangle of silk in the weeds. The silk, which exists as liquid in her body, sets at once on contact with the water, as it would in the air. These tiny spinnerets form the silk. The next job is to put the first air bubble in place. It's harder than it might seem, because the spider's hairy abdomen is designed to hold on to the bubble. But once the first bubble is trapped in the silk, later bubbles will be released into the dome more easily. When the bubble is large enough, its fine mesh-like surface loses carbon dioxide into the water and absorbs oxygen. So, to some extent, it breathes for itself. But the spider still replenishes the supply from time to time. The diving bell is the spider's base for hunting expeditions. She's an avid predator, very sensitive to vibrations in the water and equipped with sharp fangs. Since the exertion of hunting quickly uses up her portable air supply, the spider returns to feed inside the bell, where she can breathe more freely. As she grows, the spider must enlarge the dome and bring in more air to make it ready for her offspring. She spins an extra fringe around the bottom of the canopy. Finally, she lays her eggs inside the bell, packed in a cloud of fine silk. Then, her work is done. The outer covering is tough enough to resist puncture, but fine enough to let oxygen through so that the eggs can breathe. It's an elaborate structure serving as a lung for the spider and a nest for her young. On nearby weeds, the larvae of caddis flies wear quiver-shaped casings that they've built as shelter for their soft bodies. The case protects the larvae from the bite of hunters like the water spider. This species of caddis fly uses cut-up weeds as building material. The structure may appear awkward, but it's very effective camouflage. The caddis worms will live within their cases for the duration of their larval stage. When they mature into adult caddis flies and take to the air flitting on gossamer wings, they will bear no trace of these earthbound origins. In swifter streams with gravel bottoms, there's another kind of caddis. These are much more like the sand mason worm, for they build concrete tubes from tiny pebbles and grains of sand. This heavy construction and constant rebuilding helps to prevent them from washing away. They sort through countless particles of gravel in search of one just the right size to use next. The work of the caddis fly parallels the intricate stonework of human masons. These stones, collected from the surrounding land, create shelters that can endure, strong and secure, for centuries. The caddis flies, however, must constantly rebuild their gravel cases. Usually, as they grow bigger, the lower end of their tubes will crumble from the pressure of the growing worm. There are many types of caddis larvae. Each builds in its own way. One always adds a twig to its gravel sheath, perhaps to make use of the directions of the current, as the water washes away wastes and brings in food particles. Another builds exclusively with the shells of freshwater snails, creating an ornate covering. Caddisflies aren't the only larvae that build protective cases. In Australia, there are several families of moths, which during their caterpillar stage use the surrounding vegetation to build portable shelters. They're called case moths or bagworms. Their structures vary, like those of the caddises, from an apparently random collection of bits to elegant constructions built with great precision. Here, in the darkness of the Australian night, the leaf-curling spider performs another building feat of dexterity and complexity. The spider fashions a shelter from the great dead leaves of the eucalyptus tree, which tend to curl on the stem. First, the spider spins a harness around a selected leaf. The spider pulls the line of the web taut and uses it to hoist the leaf many times its own size high into the air. It has already built a web in the twigs above. The leaf will form protection beside it. Suspended above the ground, this nest will be safe from predators. The spider's silk shrinks as it dries, so if she gets the angle right, it will curl the leaf as it contracts. Delicate operation takes all night with frequent rests. The results, like this, can be elegant, natural sculpture. With its efficient use of an abundant local resource, the Australian leaf-curling spider is an accomplished animal architect. Here, on the African savanna, the environment offers different resources. People must make use of available materials to create their dwellings. The builders here use the indigenous supplies of wood, grass, and earth to construct efficient houses ideally suited to the local climate. First, they build a frame with sturdy wood stakes. Then they add grass to make joints and strengthen junctions. Later, mud will be used to create walls. The animal builders here must also depend on the same materials for their creations. One supply in abundance on the savanna is grass. Dozens of species of weaver birds use nothing else for their nests. Their first and most important task is to make a hoop of grass firmly attached at both ends. The bird ties the grass to a twig with the same type of knot as humans use. The next stage of construction of the house uses nature's most prevalent building material, earth. Mud is used extensively by builders around the world, in adobe, in brick, and in earthen hut walls. It has many advantages. It's malleable, dries quickly in the sun, and thick mud walls like these provide wonderful insulation. In this very hot climate, a house so constructed will stay cool and dry. Many animal architects exploit the same advantages of mud. Barn swallows use it. Some bees do, too. And four families of wasps have evolved their own technique for building mud nests. This wasp makes the cells of her nest one at a time. At first, the walls are soft and flexible, like those of the hut, but in the warm tropical breeze, they soon harden. Smoothing out the inside is an important finishing touch to ensure that there are no gaps. The finished cell is porous, but completely enclosed. When her cell is ready, she'll stock it with a few spiders she has paralyzed with her sting. Then she'll lay an egg among them. When the egg hatches, the grub will feed on the spiders. Capping the cell is the most difficult part of the job, but the wasp has a method which makes it easier. She collects mud in the usual way, making sure that it's very wet. Once she has it in position at the top of the entrance to the cell, she can make it runny by working it with her jaws and by adding water from her crop. This master builder makes even this tricky task seem simple. It's important to seal the cell quickly and properly to protect the egg and its food store. The wasp examines the seal closely once the mud is in place. A second lid, laid on top of the first, completes the fortress. She'll never see her offspring. By the time it emerges next season, she'll be dead. The grub feeds on the store of spiders which the female has left in the cell. Because of the risk of predation, wasps take extraordinary care to conceal the outline of the cells which they've so precisely made. They daub on rolls of mud, hiding their careful work. The finished clump of cells is a shapeless mound, disguising the delicate architecture underneath. The mud walls of the house have dried, and the dwelling is ready for the next stage of construction. The builders use thick grass thatching to make the house waterproof and to insulate it from the relentless sun. Many of the animal inhabitants on the savanna also use grass to protect themselves from the hot, dry climate. The weaver birds must keep their nests cool. Hanging in midair helps, and it keeps them out of reach of predators. Two or three layers of grass thatching make excellent insulation, especially once it's dried, pale-colored, and reflective. The bird weaves, using its beak and feet to hold the grasses it rips and twists into its basket. The final topknot on the hut's roof will prevent rain from seeping down the thatch. It is also decorative. In the world of the animal architects, there are few species as adept at adornment as the bower bird. He is the only bird builder that collects ornaments and designs a bower to lure a female for mating. There are several species of bower birds in Australia and New Guinea, and in similar ways, each prepares an arena to be the center of its territory and the site of its courtship. The spotted bower bird is a so-called avenue builder. It makes two walls of grass which become the stage for its work. This bower is not a nest or a shelter. When it is time for mating, it will be used to attract a female and sometimes for breeding. Long afterwards, the female builds a nest in a nearby tree. And that is where she will lay her eggs and rear her brood. The male bower bird will spend weeks gathering bones, shells, brightly colored pebbles, berries, and dried flowers. These are the tools of its trade. There are surprising variations from one species to another. Some bower birds are attracted to blue flowers and bits of glass. Others seem to prefer yellow. Some even smash berries and use their beaks to paint the inside of the bower with the dye. A roadside bower will inevitably be decorated with that familiar 20th century folk jewelry, pull rings from beer cans, and shiny broken glass. The bird lays out its treasures and shifts them around, creating an elaborate display of colors and shapes. When the time for mating approaches, the male calls to attract a female. Some scientists suggest that the bower bird's elaborate building behavior might compensate for its simple call and lack of colorful plumage. An animal architect with perhaps an even more unusual mission is the African antlion. Ants are a very abundant food source all over the world if an animal can digest them and if it can catch them first. Like spiders, ant lions are one of the few examples of animals that build traps to snare their prey. Neither ant nor lion, the insect lives at the bottom of a sandy pit. This is its domain for its entire larval phase until its metamorphosis into a winged adult. But its development depends on its success as a predator, for if an antlion is not well nourished, this phase may last for as long as 2 years. Their pits are dug in loose sand. The antlion first has to clear the area of larger gravel particles. Although tiny, it's an energetic creature with very powerful neck muscles, so its jaws can function like a catapult. When it's cleared the ground, it begins to excavate its pit, working in a very methodical spiral. As the pit gets deeper, it takes on the conical shape, which is the secret of its success. Larger pieces of gravel, too heavy for catapulting, set off a special behavior pattern. Then the catapulting continues until the pit is complete. The angle of the slope depends upon the dryness of the sand and the size of the particles. It's called the angle of repose, and it's the steepest angle at which the slope is stable. Anyone who has ever taken delivery of a load of sand or walked along a sand dune knows about the angle of repose. Anything added to the surface, another grain of sand or an ant, causes a little avalanche until the sand settles again. The antlion's trap is designed to be a perfect pitfall. Here, the digging of another pit is captured in time-lapse photography. The antlion digs a perfect spiral shape, a behavior of extraordinary precision. Because the pit is formed from the outside inwards, every jawful of sand that's thrown up slips into that same marginally stable angle. When the antlion has finished digging, it waits, jaws poised for a victim. The struggling of the ant makes the sand slip down, and the antlion flicks up more sand to increase the effect. Although some ants do manage to escape, more often than not, the trap is a complete success. Once the antlion has a firm grip, the ant's fate is sealed. The antlion injects gastric juices into the body of its prey. Within a few hours, the soft parts of the ant have dissolved and are sucked out by the antlion. The ant's empty, indigestible carcass is then hurled out of the funnel. A few adjustments to that deadly slope, and the trap is ready once more. The savanna has an abundance of earth, wood, grass, building materials used by many of its inhabitants. When complete, this wattle and daub house will stand as an efficient home, sturdy, dry, and cool. Throughout the world, animal builders use ordinary available materials in extraordinary ways. The harvest mouse builds its nest in the grain fields of Europe and Asia, making use of a particular characteristic of the long leaves of wheat and other grass-like plants. Grasses have parallel veins, which allows them to be split lengthwise with great accuracy. By pulling loops from one split grass leaf through the loops in another, the mouse forms a tough woven structure, similar to some of the most skillfully woven birds' nests. In addition to providing a relatively snug place to rear young, this nest also conceals and protects the mice from predators. The harvest mouse does not damage the leaf veins when she builds, and the nest therefore will stay green and hidden. The bottom of the shelter must be pulled up and knitted in to make a secure floor. The result is a sound and solid little basket, perfectly disguised in the wheat stems. The mouse's offspring will stay here for their first 2 weeks, struggling to push their way through the fabric of the nest. When they leave, the nest must be abandoned and a new one built before the arrival of the next litter. Her method is easier to follow when it's speeded up. Adult males and immature mice build similar baskets for sleeping. These are less dense since they do not have to support the strains of housing a litter. One dead leaf has been incorporated, but it's a natural color and it helps with the camouflage. When the wheat ripens, the whole nest changes color along with the rest of the field and remains hidden among the grass. The harvest mouse makes unique use of the only material available in its grassy world. No other animal takes the same advantage of the properties of parallel veined leaves. The leaves of oak and hazel trees are used by a beetle, a weevil, in another unusual way. The beetle is rarely seen at work. In fact, this is the first time it's ever been filmed making a nest. But the result of its labor, tightly rolled leaf packets still attached to branches, is often seen in hazel, birch, and poplar groves. There are hundreds of species of this beetle throughout the world. The beetle seen here is in a hazel orchard in England, but can be found in most of Europe and Asia. Its first move is to make a cut across the leaf near the stalk end. In order for the nest to provide safe shelter for her eggs, the first roll must be completely enclosed. When the roll is secure, the beetle bites a hole into the cavity to receive her egg. She may make 2 to 5 small pockets in the roll as receptacles for her tiny eggs. Usually, she will lay between 1 and 8 eggs per roll. Now, the beetle has to roll up the rest of the leaf. It's important to cover the egg hole as soon as possible to protect it from invasion by an insect. From the way that she tucks in the sides and holds them in place, it seems as if the beetle might be using some form of glue, but there's no sign of adhesive of any kind in the finished roll. More probably, she's taking advantage of the physical properties of the leaf. Once it's curled up, it tends to stay in position. As the roll gets fatter, the work gets harder, but at last, after 20 minutes of continuous effort, the end is in sight. A leaf roll usually stays on the branch for a week or so, and then as the leaf dries, will fall to the ground. When the egg hatches, the larva will begin the 2-month process of eating through the leaf. In late summer, the larva will bore into the ground. There, it will stay in a state of arrested development until the following spring. Then, it will emerge from the ground as an adult to begin a brief life of mating, egg laying, and leaf rolling. The final twist of the leaf produces an almost magical effect, which depends for success on the small cut which the beetle made right at the beginning. The leaf tilts into a vertical position, and the last flap folds over, top surface uppermost, to provide a waterproof cover for the whole construction. Nearby the orchard, another builder has adapted to the resources in its environment. Although most birds build nests in trees, these dig like rabbits into any sandy bank they can find. In the summertime in North America and Eurasia, it is not unusual to find a large, crowded colony of these swallows along the sides of gravel pits or highway embankments, or here in England, even in abandoned World War II trenches. The nesting burrows are usually dug near the top of a vertical bank. The swallow clings to the face of the cliff and digs with its bill. Once inside, the swallow will use its feet to kick dirt backwards out of the expanding burrow. The male and female take turns as diggers. The bank swallow population is shrinking as sandy banks are used as mortar for human homes. But this swallow uses mud, quite common during wet British summers, to build its nest. A barn swallow gathers mud by shuffling to the edge of a shallow puddle. There, she rolls up the wet earth. When it is dry and firm enough, she carries it off in her mouth. These birds are found throughout North America, Africa, and Asia. Long ago, before the countryside was dotted with buildings, barn swallows had to find inland cliffs for nesting, and then they must have been as scattered as bank swallows. Now, they plaster their nests onto the walls of buildings, using this as a foundation for their structures. They add layer after layer of mud droplets to create a half-bowl base. The swallows make frequent trips to gather supplies of mud, enlarging their enclosure. When the nest is complete, there will be a small opening at the top, and then this nest will be ready to provide safety and shelter for a new generation of animal builders. The architects of the animal world survive and flourish by their use of resources from their environments. And they build for many ends. To provide safe haven. To rear their young. To catch a meal. Or to avoid notice. And although their creations vary in function and complexity, from the hermit crab that simply takes possession of an empty shell, to the bower bird that builds an elaborate fortress of seduction from found treasures, there is beauty and elegance in all of their work. Thank you.